So our last presentation of the afternoon is from James Freericks. And this says...
Is this the right title?
Yeah, that's fine.
Oh, 1925 Revolution of Matrix Mechanics, How to Celebrate It in a Quantum Mechanics Class.
Okay, so I hope all of you know that 2025 is going to be the year of the quantum. It's the 100th anniversary of Heisenberg's discovery of matrix mechanics. How many of you have actually looked at Heisenberg's paper, actually know what he did? Okay, so you'll be, if you're able to follow what I talk about, I hope you'll be amazed at what actually comes out of this. So it started in 1925, and I just asked that question. So there were three papers in the summer and fall of 1925. The first one was Über Quanten theoretische Umdeutung kinematischer und mechanischer Beziehungen, and that means the quantum mechanical relations, kinematics, and mechanical redefinitions. And then the second paper was the incredibly titled Zur Quantenmechanik on quantum mechanics. And then the third one was Zur Quantenmechanik II. So they had very ingenious titles for the papers. In this talk, I'm not going to give you a historical account. What I'm going to actually show you is how it's done and how you could talk about it in your quantum mechanics class. I think it's actually very interesting. You might want to consider actually spending a lecture talking about what was actually done. So I'm going to show you the art and the beauty of how matrix mechanics works. Now, in the old quantum theory in 1925 was Bohr-Sommerfeld quantization. You had periodic motion, you integrate the action around a period, you set it equal to an integer multiplied by h bar. What is remarkable is when Sommerfeld did his calculation of the relativistic hydrogen atom, they got the spectral lines. The relativistic energies of hydrogen were known before quantum mechanics was invented. It, of course, fails for other atoms. It's tedious to apply, and it has lots of other problems with it. But that's really remarkable. Not just the non-relativistic, but the actual relativistic spectral lines. So what they were actually measuring in hydrogen. The ideas were based on Ehrenfest's notion of adiabatic invariance. These are quantities that are unchanged when a parameter is changed very slowly. The example is, if I took a harmonic oscillator and slowly changed its frequency, E over omega remains conserved. Even though the energy changes and the frequency changes, the ratio doesn't change. And that's the thing that's quantized. So if I take E over omega and set it equal to h bar times n, you see I would get the energy of the harmonic oscillator as h bar omega n. That's almost right. And so this was the idea that they were using in the old quantum theory to try to work on quantum mechanics itself. Now, in classical mechanics, when you have periodic motion, you get a response that is at the fundamental frequency and the harmonics of that frequency. So the expectation in spectroscopy was to see harmonics of fundamental frequencies. But they didn't. They saw energy differences. This is called the Rydberg-Ritz combination principle. So how can I expand a theory in energy differences? The idea of Heisenberg was to use matrices. So if I take a matrix for position that I call QMN and one for momentum that I call PMN, and the MN dependence depends on the energies EM and EN in the way that is written here, e to the I omega MN T, where omega MN is just the energy difference divided by H bar, I'm going to show you that just from that assumption, you will find not only that the canonical commutation relation is non-zero, you'll be able to show that it's exactly equal to IH bar. Okay, so how do I work with matrices? What does it even mean? Well, the first thing that he wanted to do is have the the first way that I want to describe to you how you should think about it is you want the correspondence principle to hold. So you want these objects to satisfy the Heisenberg equation of motion. So the time derivative of position is given by, I can calculate it directly because I know the time dependence of the matrix element, but it's given by that omega MN is the energy difference. The Hamiltonian is diagonal and time independent in this representation. So the diagonal elements are E1, E2, E3, etc. So EM minus EN times QMN is just the product of H times Q minus Q times H. So just by enforcing the classical equation of motion, you get the Heisenberg equation of motion for the matrices. So that just comes out immediately. Now the next thing is we can use this to show, if we use the equation of motion for momentum as well, we can show that there's no time dependence to this commutator between Q and P. So if I just distribute that derivative, Q dot P plus QP dot, substitute in from these equations, Q dot is proportional to P, P dot is proportional to dV dQ, you see I get a commutator of P with P and a commutator of Q with a function of Q. Both those commutators are zero. So you learn that this canonical commutation relation is independent of time. Now, you also can show that it is a diagonal matrix. So to do that, we use the Heisenberg equation of motion. So the time derivative is equal to the commutator of H with the canonical commutation relation. That's equal to EM minus EN times that, and that's equal to zero. Well, if I have a non-degenerate problem, so EM never equals EN unless M equals N, the only way that that is zero is can be, the only way I can satisfy that that thing is equal to zero is if the commutator QP, thought of as a matrix now, is a diagonal matrix. So it has a diagonal matrix element that we'll call CM times delta MN. And now the final piece that you have to put in is to look at the definition of momentum. It is M times Q dot. We use Heisenberg equation of motion to calculate Q dot, commutator of H with Q. We plug in what H is, and we find that we get P times the commutator of Q with P plus QP times the commutator of P. That's called the Leibniz rule for a commutator. But the commutator is a diagonal matrix. So if I write this out in matrix elements, it's the equation that I've given you there, and you get IH bar PMN is 1 half CM plus CN times PMN. We're almost there. Now, the canonical commutation relation can't depend on what Hamiltonian I'm using. We know that the diagonal basis for one Hamiltonian is different from the diagonal basis of another Hamiltonian. So this commutation relation has to be invariant if I change the basis that I'm working in for different Hamiltonians. The only matrix that doesn't change if you change the basis is the identity matrix. So you learn from this that this diagonal matrix must be proportional to the identity, and then this equation gives you the proportionality. It's IH bar. So you can actually derive the canonical commutation relation just from these two ideas about matrix mechanics. So now, how do we use this to solve the hydrogen problem? So we just learned that the commutator of Q with P is IH bar times the identity matrix. Again, P is M times Q dot. And we know how to calculate Q dot because it's the derivative with that exponential behavior. So it's IM omega MN times the matrix Q. And we can now look at the MN matrix element of the commutator of Q with P. We just substitute in that expression for P that we got above. It looks a little complicated. Just trust me that it is correct. We're going to evaluate it when M is equal to N. When M equals N, the right-hand side is equal to IH bar. And the left-hand side becomes twice omega mm prime times the modulus of q mm prime squared, and that's equal to minus h bar over 2m. Don't worry, that's correct. There's no sign error there. Omega mm prime is a negative number, so that is okay. But this is an expression that you get from the canonical commutation relation written now in a matrix form. And finally, now to solve the harmonic oscillator, classical equation of motion becomes omega mn squared minus omega squared times the matrix Q is equal to zero. You can factorize that. It's a difference of two squares. That tells you omega mn is equal to plus omega or minus omega. That tells you that you can only have a non-zero element in the Q matrix if the m and n differ by plus or minus one. Again, remember, you guys know this from harmonic oscillator, but here we inferred it without any operators or differential equation or anything like that. In fact, now, for the ground state, there's only one non-zero element because I can't lower the ground state. So I use the formula I derived on the previous page. We can learn that Q01 squared is equal to h bar over 2m omega. We plug that in to calculate what H00 is. It's p squared over 2m plus 1 half m omega squared q squared. And you find, when all the dust settles, it's equal to 1 half h bar omega. So we just found the ground state energy of the harmonic oscillator. But we also just learned that the energy differences are h bar omega. So we've just actually now found all of the energy levels of hydrogen. So that's how this works. And it's pretty remarkable how the logic goes. I know I went through this rather quickly, but if you want, I can give you more details about it, or you can look at it again. So in matrix mechanics, you calculate spectra without determining the eigenstates or the eigenfunctions. That's pretty cool. I personally think it's truly beautiful how all this fits together. You don't have to postulate the canonical commutation relation. You can just say, I want quantum mechanics to agree with classical mechanics, and I have to represent quantum objects by matrices because of spectroscopy, and from that you get commutator of Q with P is IH bar. So the one thing that's really unfortunate about this is it only works for the harmonic oscillator and the rigid rotor, and that's why it lost favor in terms against the Schrödinger wave function approach, which works for many other problems. And then I'll just end with recognizing my collaborators on this, Leanne Dowdy and Jason Tran, and this is work funded by the Air Force Office of Scientific Research.
Thank you. I appreciate seeing that because, and I'm thinking about using it. So it's nice to be able to make that connection rather than hand waving and not really explaining anything, which is what I did in the past.
It's what we all do. It's so much nicer to be able to actually derive it rather than having to postulate it. Yeah.
Do we have any other comments or questions?
A comment. It's nice to be looking back at the beginning. Sometimes some of the at least popular discussion about quantum information seems to suggest that quantum is something that was invented maybe around circa 2000 or something. Remember, this stuff goes back a long time. We've been doing quantum mechanics for quite some time.
Yeah. And those guys really knew what they were doing. I didn't talk about the history. But the history is fascinating as well, and there's some really nice books that have come out recently. There's one by Duncan and Jansen called Constructing Quantum Mechanics in 2 volumes. Highly recommend it. And there's a very interesting new textbook by Golub and Lemereau that weaves history into the way they talk about quantum mechanics. So if you're interested in learning more about that, those are two very good sources to take a look at.
All right, thanks, James, once again.